Hi, everybody. Jersey girls bolstered by coffee, my favorite thing. A few of us are old enough to remember a time when women couldn't start their own business without getting her husband's or father's signature, or get a credit card, for that matter. Okay, two of us can remember that. A few of us remember celebrating the civil rights milestone Congress passed in 1988 that gave women access to capital to start their own business. It was called House Resolution 5050. We are so far away from 5050. Equal pay for equal work. The World Economic Forum ranks the United States 65th out of 142 countries behind Zimbabwe. Jersey's gap is the widest in the nation. It was reported this past week. 68.9 cents on the dollar. But I digress. Today, for the first time in American history, there are more women in the American workforce than men. 40% of mothers are the sole or primary breadwinner for their family. But just 5% of CEOs in the S&P 500 are women. And 16.5% of top execs, not including CEOs, are women. Pulling women into C-suites isn't just the right thing to do, it's the profitable thing to do. Gender diversity is good for business. A Catalyst study demonstrates companies with more women in top management outperform those that don't, delivering 34% greater returns to shareholders. And that 5% of Fortune 100 companies' female CEOs generate 7% of the Fortune 1000 total revenue. What can the business world do to grow the number of women in the C-suites? That's what we're here to find out from a group of extraordinary people. From your right, Gail Mandel, President and CEO of Wyndham Destination Network, the world's largest provider of professionally managed unique vacation accommodations. Who has time for a vacation? You want a houseboat, a rental, a cottage? She's got a line on more than 110,000 cool properties. She oversees the overall operations and strategy for the timeshare exchange and vacation rentals business. She began her career in the financial industry as a senior auditor at Deloitte & Touche, and she's a huge Giants fan. Philippa Gerling, yes. Philippa Gerling is Senior Vice President, Chief Risk Officer at Investors Bank. She oversees the bank's BSA compliance and credit risk departments. Her experience in global securities and operational risk make her a recognized industry leader, named one of the decade's top 50 faces in operational risk. She's written two textbooks on the subject. She's been recognized by Working Mother magazine as one of the top 100 working mothers in America, and she has five daughters, which is work enough, who are launched and living in Berlin, Vienna, New York, and New Orleans, where they can no longer procure her best clothes. I have three of those myself. Daughters, not clothes. Anyway, Mike Fucci is chairman of the board at Deloitte LLP, overseeing everything: strategy, brand positioning, risk mitigation, talent development, and leadership succession. He also chairs the Deloitte Foundation. In 2008, Mike was named Consulting Magazine's Distinguished Top 25 Consultant list. Mike is a sought-after speaker, and one of his top three favorite movies is Saturday Night Fever. I'm waiting for him to go for us. Elizabeth Forminard is Worldwide Vice President, Corporate Governance at Johnson & Johnson, a regulatory lawyer who's held a host of key leadership positions at J&J and Pfizer. Her global cross-functional view, born in part by agreeing at 6 months pregnant to board an airplane, fly to Australia, and establish a legal department. She got there, she set up her law office, she had a baby, and her last name is made up. Jared Forman wanted to marry Elizabeth Menard, so she negotiated a compromise on the name. Forman-ard, he's the one who lost the vowel. Bernie Flynn is president and CEO of NJM Insurance Company, prior to that deputy attorney general for the state of New Jersey and counsel for the commissioner of insurance. He volunteers with charities like Greater Trenton and Choose New Jersey to attract businesses and build up our inner cities. He's on the board of the Rutgers Business School's Institute for Ethical Leadership and on our board at New Jersey Public Television. Thank heaven. Bernie taught math and reading in Washington, D.C. in the same Jesuit, God bless him, outreach program as Hillary Clinton's ticket mate, Tim Kaine. There you have it. So Barry Ostrowski just said that women's underrepresentation on boards is by design. Let's all talk about the role of men in changing this. Who wants to start? Bernie, you're on.
Thank you, Mary Alice. Getting put on the spot. We might have to invite Barry Ostrowski up here to help us out. It is endemic in the industry that I represent. Property casualty insurance. Very conservative. Grown up over time with white males, middle age, dominating the industry. We have work to do. So I'm representative of sort of a middle market company that doesn't have the kind of opportunities governance-wise, the opportunities with scale that may come from some of the other company representatives up here. And I'm here to tell you that I agree with Barry's thesis. It is something that has grown up through whether it's intellectual intimidation, a desire to have the people that you work with look and think like you. It's happened over decades. Now, with that, I see opportunity in our industry, because we are behind even those woeful numbers that Mary Alice and Barry and Michelle have given you. Every time in our company, and I talk to my fellow executives, white males, that there is a significant position, either on the board for the CEO or in the C-suite, there's almost a panic that we have to have, you know, a broad panel of candidates. We don't want the dynamic to be one of desperation. There are plenty of talented female executives out there. How we develop them, which is a white male responsibility for the most part, given our present circumstances, is critically important. Because we hire entry level in a very diverse fashion as an industry and in our company. But you have to give opportunity. And I think, you know, Barry is absolutely right when, if the criteria is for board service that you have previously served on a similar type board, you're not going to get the diversity, whether it's gender or otherwise, that you desire, certainly not in our industry. So this is something that, you know, is top of mind. I do see opportunity.
But you have to convince the guys they're wrong, right? How do you do that, Mike?
Well, I think it's not just only about convincing the guys that they're wrong. It's getting people comfortable with flexibility. So I know we like to talk about the board and the C-suite, but to me, it's also about the pipeline. And I look to my own experience, and I know that I wouldn't be sitting here today if it wasn't for the man who is running our company, who's not here today, our chairman, because at the time, about 14 years ago, when my older son was 1 year old, I walked in and I said, I can't do this. I've got to make a choice, and I'm working 7 days a week, and I just can't do this anymore. So thanks so much, and good luck. And he said, no, thank you. Let me have the day to think about it. And he did something that was unheard of in our organization at the time. Now, our chairman is, we spun off from Cendant 10 years ago, so he's our chairman today. He was not the chairman of the company at the time when it was Cendant. And he came back to me with a proposal to take a more limited role in the organization so that I could find my balance between work and my new baby. And I did that for 8 years. I have two sons. And then when the time came where there was an opportunity and both my sons were in school full time, I then came back full time to work. But it's that flexibility at the point where, and generally it is women who are making the choice whether or not to stay with their career or to leave it. And I truly believe if we give that flexibility earlier on, we're going to have a greater pipeline to choose from. And so that's my experience, and I actually am a huge advocate, and I do that with my own team now in order to make that happen and to give people those choices.
Mike?
It's interesting.
Thank you, Gail.
I look at it, when Barry was talking, it really resonated with me because I think we're running a race and we're behind. So you could keep running the same race or you could change the game. And I actually think you have to change the game. If you looked at Deloitte statistics right now, we have a female CEO. We have a female CEO of our biggest business. We have 33% of our board is female. So you could say, oh, guys, you did that. We have the same exact pipeline issue as every other company. So yes, we've today, if you took a snapshot of our leadership today, you'd say we've done it. But we have the same exact issues. Regardless of what we have at the top level, people are still making those same, having those same issues and choices that Gail said earlier. And so it's not something you can solve and then check a box. It's something that is a continual function that you have to keep doing because it's not just amount one or two, getting one or two people in leadership roles. Because even our young women look up and see our senior CEOs and they still have the same issues. It doesn't really, they love the fact that they have women at the top of the house, but it doesn't help solve their issue today as a manager who is struggling with, you know, travel and any other, whatever issues are in their lives. So it is something that has to continue to, it's not a box checker exercise.
Philippa?
Well, I'm going to be a little radical on this one and say, we're very used to our perspective here. So what we're used to as women working in America, and obviously I started in England, but in America, is the supportive framework that exists systemically. So I had an interesting opportunity to go to Iceland, beautiful by the way, wherever you want to go. I went to Iceland just after, well, about 3 years after the crisis, and I was speaking to the chief risk officer there, who's a woman, and she has two young children. Now, I'm a chief risk officer. I do not have young children. I have grown-up children who don't steal my clothes anymore. She has small children. That's possible for her because the infrastructure there allowed her 1 year off for maternity. Now, I know we're not going to get 1 year off for maternity here. Don't get me wrong. I realize we're many, many years away from that happening here. But what was interesting to me, it was completely normal. Nobody thought that it was shocking that she was taking a year off. And if she had been a single father, he also could take the year off, not an issue at all. So I talked to her a bit about it and said, how is it that you're able to have this very high pressure job and children? And she said, people understand that I need balance. I don't have to sacrifice work for balance. It's expected. And then one other thing they did at the board level, which was truly radical, is they decided that part of the reason they had fared so badly in the crisis in Iceland, and they did fare very badly, was because they only had men on the board. They had no diversity on the board. So they fired the whole board and rehired it 50-50. And then they made a pledge that by 2018, they'd have 50% of women at every level of the bank. So that's pretty radical. So some of the things I think we could do, to your point, Barry, is be more radical. Don't be comfortable with small incremental change. I think the firms that take the radical route and decide to innovate to get women to the top will be the ones who are more successful and have higher profit margins and success. They will survive crisis more effectively.
Can that be done? I have a million questions, Philippa, but go.
Well, I'm afraid we're all going to be in violent agreement on this point, but I just want to add that I think that infrastructure is, in fact, key, having people who are devoted to it, and I really, Barry's comments resonated tremendously with me, having people who are devoted to it and having a mandate of a diverse slate for top positions is incredibly important. However, you know, if you think of that saying about when's the best time to plant a tree, you know, 20 years ago, when's the next best time today, you really do need to have infrastructure that is part of your DNA in your organization that enables you to know when every opportunity, because it's little opportunities like compounding interest that build careers and make people prepared to be on those slates when that moment comes for the big position. And if you have a robust talent development process and a succession planning process that forces you as a company to regularly sit down and say, wow, our emerging talent is not very diverse. What are we going to do about that? Well, that starts at recruiting. Okay, good. So if you've got recruiting, so you're bringing in, and we do, and I'm fortunate to be at a company that's pretty far along this journey, 46% of J&J's 130,000 employees are women. How do you grow them and build their careers and develop them all the way through? It comes down to saying, with every opportunity that's given out, whether it's given out on the golf course or not, that you are mindful and intentional that you're giving those opportunities out in a way that helps you to plant those seeds so that you have people who have had the experiences they need to have by the time, you know, the big job comes. And that you also, frankly, ask them what their aspiration is all the way through their career as managers so that you have in mind, oh my gosh, I would have made an assumption about this person based on maybe the fact that she has five children, but actually now I know that what she wants is a, you know, a geographic move and she's up for that. So asking that and putting it, planting those seeds all the way along, I think it's very important.
And Mary Alice, what Liz is describing is is a governance and a sustainability. You know, Barry can come in here and give a wonderful speech and get us all excited, and we can meet to that. But what Barry's doing in his organization is creating an infrastructure, a culture, a governance structure that when he retires will sustain itself. And I think that's important for all of us up here to really remember and take away that we can talk about our anecdotes and they're important, but the sustainability of this type of an approach, you know, a cultural shift is so critical in all our organizations, no matter how big and small.
Yeah. What I'm hearing from everybody is that, from my own perspective, you know, I come from a generation that was kicking doors in, and what I'm hearing from you guys is that it's you guys who are actually opening the doors. It's not the young women who have to do the kicking anymore, which is really interesting. But Philippa, you talked about a year leave after having a baby. That's true all over Europe, that you could, there are long maternity leaves and, you know, fully paid and whatnot. How much of this in America has to come from industry, and how much of it is a government program?
Well, I think it's both. I really do. I think even if we had the program, we'd still have the issue. And so there's a fundamental, which is you have to make it possible for people to grow their families and have careers. If we don't have that fundamental baseline, we're always going to have women struggling to balance a very busy work life and a very busy home life. So, yes, I do think there's a political issue here that does need to be addressed. But in the industry, we also need to address it internally. We need to look at our own maternity leave. Within a company, are we giving people 3 weeks off? Are we giving them 3 months off? How are we making sure that our top talent is able to have children, enjoy that growth of a family, and come back to work fully functional? So I've had some interesting conversations over the years with women who are pregnant, who are deeply afraid that while they're out on maternity leave, they will be forgotten, and that when they come back, they'll be less valued. And that's in companies that have really quite nice, generous maternity leave. And that's because the other issue is, how are you perceived? And is there some kind of unconscious bias around you've chosen to take time off to have a child? Obviously, that's important to you. You never hear someone say to a man, I hear that you've had a child. Are you sure you want to continue in a role that's this challenging? That just doesn't happen. So I think the unconscious bias that still exists around having children and growing family is something that we need to get through in the industry level, but we absolutely need the political benchmark, which allows people to take time off and feed themselves, because you can't just take time off and earn nothing. So they need to be able to take time off, nurture their family, and come back fully functional.
The comment that you just made, Philippa, about unconscious bias, I think is such a critical factor, that nobody is intentionally trying to take away an opportunity from someone who's out on maternity leave. But what often happens is assumptions are made by the fact that the person's not there, and having voices in the room to, you know, whether it's a sponsor for that particular individual or if it's just a reminder to everyone around the table, let's not make an assumption, I think is critically important. And that comes from both the culture, tone at the top, infrastructure programs like maternity leave and parental leave, by the way, because increasingly men are interested in having time off to bond with their children too. But it's, you know, it's just making sure that we aren't making those wrong assumptions.
Interesting.
Go ahead, Mike.
It's interesting. We jumped right to flexibility quickly, which always happens. I actually think flexibility is the biggest issue we have to deal with. However, it isn't the only issue. Men are afraid to give women direct feedback like they give men feedback. That is absolutely there. And when a lot of people in our firm will sit down to me and say, listen, I want to give my senior manager, who's very talented, some direct feedback about the fact that she's too this or that, and I'm afraid to give her that feedback. So what happens is they don't give it, but it's either water cooler talk or they take it into account somehow. Yep. And I'm like, really? I mean, you give feedback to anyone. So this, you know, I think we have to get around this generalities. I mean, the issue is,
why are they afraid to give direct feedback?
To be honest with you, you know, there's a bit of a political correctness around that. If they look like a man giving a woman very direct feedback, that will, you know, not be taken well. There's just a lot of different norms that we need to break, I believe, on stuff like that, where men will give men tough feedback.
And I think I totally agree with you, Mike. It's funny that you say that, because there are many layers to this issue, and you're right, flexibility is one, and I use my personal story there. But it's actually funny. I had a very talented manager come to me, and good thing is that our environment is a very open, diverse, and inclusive environment. So he came to me and he said, one of my leaders is coming back from maternity leave. When she comes back next week, what do I say to her? Should I say congratulations? Should I ignore it? I said, well, she had a baby, so that's a big moment in her life. I would say congratulations would be a good thing. And then I said, kind of help her to get back into the fact it's a hard transition when you come back from maternity leave, and help her to get back into the swing of things. So it is interesting, I agree with you, that there is a lot of coaching that needs to go on. We've spent a lot of time in our organization, and it is about tone from the top, but it spent a lot of time talking about meaningful conversations and being able to give that direct feedback, a female giving the direct feedback to a male, because at this point, about 30% of my senior leadership team and my division is female. 25% of Wyndham Worldwide's leadership team is female at this point. So we actually have the reverse, where I've had to be coached because I've been told, well, you're talking to him as if he's a woman. And I said, wow, I didn't realize that. And he's not hearing you. And so it is, for us to just ignore the difference, I think, is what's happened in the past. I think we just have to realize that we do hear things differently, gender specific, whether it's culturally also. You know, 60% of my business is outside the United States. So culturally, I know that when I'm speaking to my Danish colleagues, it's a little bit different than I'm speaking to my British colleagues. So I think all of this has to just be open. And as Mike said, we can't be as worried about political correctness. We have to make sure that the people are hearing us and that we're also listening to make sure that they did hear our message.
The old what I heard you say was, and then you repeat it?
Yeah. I do that all the time. Did you mean this? Okay, well, I think I'm going to do this now. Is that what you wanted me to do? I even do that with my boss, and I've been working for him for 23 years at this point, because we aren't the same gender, and sometimes I interpret things differently.
It's one, Mike's right. I don't know where it comes from when there's the inability to give female co-workers or female executives That direct feedback, it does happen. Let me say for the record, it's the guy's fault. And that leads me to the conversation that Barry and I had earlier. This conference needs to be gender diverse.
I was just going
right?
to ask that.
So,
where's a point at which half this room is male?
I think you know, some of it's marketing and how we approach it. My comment to Barry and to Betty Boros was, you know, if I see it, and I'm not invited as a speaker, and I see it come across, you know, my inbox, and it's women's leadership panel, I'm ignoring it quickly. You know, so I think, you know, there's a marketing element that we can certainly enhance. And when you have Barry Ostrowski giving the keynote and the passion that he brings to this issue, you know, the true kind of exemplification of tone at the top, and you get Mike, myself, others, you know, who are very interested and are thrilled that we're invited to participate, I think we can get the male executives out here. But I will say, for that situation, which happens regularly, where the male executive is either intimidated, fearful, or doesn't know how to give appropriate feedback to a female colleague, I'd want to send him to this conference, in part as part of his own development. You know, there are plenty of development opportunities and awareness opportunities that the BIA can facilitate, that this type of a conference can really help with. But the mentality and the approach, I think, needs to be, you know, a women's or a gender diversity conference has to be gender diverse, you know, from the get-go. And that's the primary objective. So we can have full and fair discussion so that, you know, the male executives can hear this.
Is there a role that shareholders can play, or even consumers can play, in forcing more diversity in the C-suites?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I would say that moment is here and it's happening right now. In the current role that I'm in, I have the privilege of sitting with Johnson & Johnson's board of directors. And one of the areas of focus, not just for Johnson & Johnson, but for, I think, really all companies these days, is on factors other than just the financial performance. That's not just the way that companies are being measured. And it's gone beyond just the socially responsible investor base. There are very mainstream, very large institutional investors right now who are looking at what they call ESG factors. That's environment, social, and governance factors. And it is things like sustainability in the sort of environmental sense of, you know, what is being potentially released, you know, through the manufacture of products, what is the total product life cycle and responsibility of a company, to social factors like, you know, human rights within a supply chain, but also to diversity. For all of the good business reasons that we've talked about, that companies, you know, there are a lot of studies and there are measures that show that companies that have diversity at the top and also throughout their ranks perform better. So this is something that major shareholders are looking at, demanding, and increasingly measuring. And, you know, what gets measured gets done. And what gets rewarded gets done twice. So this is definitely a trend that is putting some positive pressure.
Anybody else on that?
I'm hesitating because I'm not sure as many people are putting pressure as we would like them to be. I think in the larger corporations, you're going to have investment funds who are going to take large pieces of stock in an organization and then drive better behavior.
Yes.
What I would love to see is every individual shareholder waving their share certificate in the air saying, where's the diversity?
I agree. Pleased but not satisfied.
Right. So I think there's more to be done. And it's forums like this mean that everybody here can be asking that question of any company that they have any ownership in. But I think there's probably quite a long way to go on that side. And most of the pressure that I see that's most successful is at the board level. We see board members very engaged in this topic. More so perhaps even than the management throughout the organization. I think the boards tend to bring an objectivity to the table where they don't carry quite as much unconscious bias into the boardroom because they're not working day to day in an environment. They can just look at the whole organization and say, how is it performing and why isn't there diversity instead of the day-to-day conversation, which is, shall I hire this person? They don't really look like me or feel like me, so I'm a little uncomfortable, so I'll just go with Bob, who I know what his handicap is. And that's just an easy transition that people can make in the workplace. But I think the board perhaps are putting more pressure on than the shareholders in the smaller organizations.
I do something as easy. It's quite simple. It's we don't have product. It's professional services. But I'm asked a lot of times to go, you know, to a big opportunity with a client. And I'll look at the team. And my first question is, who are we presenting to? And they'll say, you know, the chief information officer, the CFO, the CEO. They'll give me five people, and two of them are women. And then I'm like, okay, who is the team? I'm looking at our team, and it's John and Joe. I'm like, duh. I mean, the first problem is, let's look like our client. Let's start looking like our client. So let's have a woman partner run this engagement, because there's a qualified woman partner to do this. I mean, there's some very easy things you could do to kind of start that.
You already have a woman partner. Let's talk about strategies that you've seen, examples of leadership development programs that you've all used.
So one of the things that we did a while ago, as I said, we spun off about 10 years ago, is we started these associate business groups. So it's more than just about women, but we do have women on their way. And then we have Spectrum, and we have Fuerte for our Hispanic population, and we have different groups, so that the groups have an opportunity to talk about what they'd like to see the leadership of the organization do to further make them feel more comfortable, to help them advance their needs. Because it's once again recognizing that we all do have differences culturally as well as from a gender standpoint. So for example, Women on Their Way, that group will come together and then they'll present some of the ideas that they have. One of them was that we were definitely having an issue with women in technology in our company. So we started a Women in Technology Mentor Circle to help those women really talk about what do they really need in what is a very male-dominated sector of our organization. So I think that's been really successful for us, having those associate business groups. And part of why it's been so successful is because our leadership, go back to tone from the top. I know it's like management 101, but it's that simple. Our leadership then takes these recommendations, and we sit as a senior leadership team and figure out how to implement them and figure out how to adjust our approach. Because if we have a portion of our population that's saying that they're not comfortable or they don't feel like they're getting the right opportunities or as many opportunities, that's bad for business. And we know that companies that have diversity of thought are the ones that are the most successful. So that is one area where I think we're continuing to make strides. Are we perfect in every area? Absolutely not. And we know that there are certain portions of our population that still feel like they're underrepresented. But awareness is the first step, and then taking action is the next.
One thing we did, when I was in my prior role at Deloitte, I was the chief operating officer of Deloitte Consulting, and leadership development was part of my role. So what I said is, when you get to a certain level, when we're looking at replacing leaders, I said everybody has to bring to me four candidates, what I called a vertical candidate. So someone who was in, like, if we were replacing the head of supply chain, somebody who was a supply chain person, a horizontal candidate, someone who was a peer but in a different part of the organization. So maybe you look at a finance person. I said you need to bring someone who's a woman and someone who's of diverse background to every opportunity. And they would, what? Of course it's Bob, or even if, of course it's Jane, but every opportunity they had to bring four candidates to the table. Now, in every case, you maybe went with Bob, but you know what it did? It raised the conversation around the other three people. And a lot of times, probably more than 50%, those people were then next to get a role in the organization. And so just something like that. Now, people got so annoyed at me because they thought it was a waste of time. But ultimately, and that was sustainable, because I'm not even in that role anymore, and they still do it. And people have said, oh, I've gotten an opportunity to be the, you know, EVP of this division. And it was because I was looked at as a horizontal candidate, not someone who was just brought up in a vertical. So,
yeah, I think that's incredibly powerful, what you just described, Mike, is when somebody comes to you, right, because they want you to approve an offer that they want to make, or they say, this is the final candidate, you know, can you, you know, meet with them? If the question you ask next is, let me see what the slate looked like that got you to this point, And if the answer is a slate that is not at all diverse, and you send that person, not because you're mean, but because you're determined, back to the drawing board and say, no, you know what, you need to go back through to the recruiting process and you need to get a diverse slate because this is not representative of the talent pool for this sort of position. That will make an incredible impression because it's highly inconvenient for the person, right? And you're also showing that, you know, this is something I am measuring and it's important to me. So all of the, you know, sort of women's leadership programs in the world won't make a dent if you don't actually, where the rubber hits the road, demand that there be diversity in the slate that you're looking at.
And I think one of the things you have to push against a lot, too, is I've had people say to me, well, we don't want to dilute talent. I've had people say that before. First of all, that's just
we don't want to dilute talent.
What is that? Passive aggressive way of saying we don't want any women in the boardroom.
it's a very passive aggressive way of saying, well, we're not going to settle on someone as a candidate. And this isn't in my current organization, by the way. We're not going to settle on someone as a candidate because they meet the diversity factor. And I've pushed back on that a lot to say, okay, I have two issues with that. One is, you are probably not able to truly evaluate what the right talent is because you carry unconscious bias. The bias that you're bringing to the table means that you just are looking for something that mirrors you and you're looking for something that makes you comfortable. And so you're going to think that the best talent is the one that's most like you. It just can't be helped. I had a very interesting study in one organization I was in. They were looking at personality traits, and we all did studies of what kind of person are you, what's your power paradigm, we've all done these things. And they shared with us that in this very complex questionnaire, there was some certain indicators that would show if you were a psychopath. And they said, we've only ever had two psychopaths. One worked for the other.
Oh, perfect.
You're like, okay, so that works as an unconscious bias. So first of all, you're not diluting talent. It may be hard for you to understand that talent. So you need diversity in the interview panel in order to be able to really look. And then the second is, and this is a little more challenging, is I have at times hired someone who I don't think is the best person for the job because they bring diversity, which makes them the best person for the team. Because the individual contribution of one person might always be that the perfect person to do that one task looks a certain way, but the dynamics of the team would be very homogeneous if we did that. And if you bring in diversity and you have people who are a little out of their comfort zone, actually that team is going to be much better performing. Study after study has shown that a diverse team outperforms a non-diverse team every single time. Creativity, problem solving, conflict resolution, even if the IQ of the team is lower. So we know that diversity works, and so I always push back on, I don't want to dilute talent. I'm saying I want to diversify my talent, and I need to diversify my interview pool to make sure I get it. And let's be bold and take a risk on somebody because they're going to contribute to the team and the outcome for the firm as a team member, not just as an individual contributor.
Because diversity, I can only speak from journalism because it's all I know and I'm underqualified for absolutely everything else except laundry and stealing my daughter's clothes. But in the newsrooms, diversity is important because we reflect the audience. We reflect Americans. So we come from different educational backgrounds and socioeconomic backgrounds and gender and ethnicity and sexual orientation, all of that, because to one story, we have all those different ideas on why that story is important and why it matters. Is that the same in the corporate world?
It's very true in problem solving. Because you can think, this is how I'd solve this problem. Someone else throws something else in and you're like, that's a very odd perspective, but it's their perspective. And it's that you need in order to be able to come up with a better solution than you could have done.
And I think what we have to remember is sometimes, look, in our day-to-day lives, we're all running fast and you want to check the box. And what Mike's talking about, what he did, makes people have to take an extra step, which means that, you know, it's a marathon, it's not a sprint, and we all have to remember that, and you have to take those extra couple of moments. And we've continued to work, maybe we need to steal from what Mike did, but we've continued to work to make sure that we bring a diverse slate for all of our positions so that we are getting the opportunity to bring that diversity of thought into the equation, because I do agree, but it's also about then having an open environment where people can express their opinions and they can trust that they're not going to be shot down as soon as they express a diverse opinion. So that back to the leaders creating that environment.
And that leads to good decision making. So that's part of diversity brings value. So in the corporate world, you've got to make the business case. And maybe it starts out as an optic in the minds of some people, mm-hmm. but you're gonna, if you have diversity of thought in your, whatever room it is, you know, the team or the boardroom, C-suite, whatever project you're working on, you have to have diversity of thought in order to come to the best decisions. And when you make that business case for diversity, and it goes well beyond the optic, then the real chance for sustainability comes. We're a company that has 1 million individual customers who live in the state of New Jersey. New Jersey is the most, one of the most, if not the most diverse states in the country.
It's the most.
The most. Mm-hmm. So it's good business for us not only to reflect our customers, but to have that diversity of thought so that we can serve them to the utmost. It brings value. So that's the, you know, for the corporate world, make the business case.
Questions from you guys. Is there anything in specific that you would like to hear them talk about?
Yes.
I was going to say you and the blue pashmina shawl, but we all have one.
Because it's really cold. It's really cold in this room, right?
It's
for a
freezing.
Women's conference. We're always freezing.
Here she is. First, I'd just like to say that it is so, I think, rewarding to hear from this panel, not about what we're doing wrong, because I think sometimes you come to these about how you have to behave differently, be more like a man. And so to listen to a panel talk about how the industry, how the CEOs, how the boards need to change their mindset versus we as women, how we have to present ourselves, it's amazing to hear this. But because we are mostly women in this room, I'm wondering from your perspective, how do we then take those entry points with our leadership? Obviously, I'm probably interested in diversity in more ways than one, more than just gender. Diversity is very important. It's nice to hear this leadership. So how do we, what are our action steps? How do we get our leaders to say, to understand this, the importance of this? I think one thing you said, Bernie, was business case. Make the business case for it. But I think, you know, being that, again, that we're the mostly women in this room and we're the ones wanting to move forward, how do we make that business case to our leadership?
So I will give a try at that and then see what others have to say. I think that as an individual, you don't necessarily have to go in and make a business case as much as you have to take it upon yourself to jointly own your own professional development and ask for what you want. And do it in a way that is not so much just what can be done for you, but what you can do for your company or your organization, and come in and say, I would love to have an opportunity in X area. And then be careful what happens, because especially if you're speaking to people of action, I suddenly found myself on a plane to Australia, and it was not an accident, but I had said, you know, I love what I'm doing right now. I was leading the regulatory legal function for Pfizer Consumer Healthcare at the time. It was a great job. And I said, you know, I'd love to get some experience in other areas of the law. And I can't do that here, but you know, I'd be open to an opportunity. And the next thing I knew, the opportunity that was presented was 10,000 miles away. I was enormously pregnant by the time I went, and it was like nothing anyone wanted to talk about. I'm like, I know I'm pregnant. It's okay. We can talk about it. I'm not
and
tall.
And they let you on a plane?
Yeah. And I had to have a doctor's note to get on the plane because it was my second child. It looked like twins. But so you have to. I mean, it's asking for what you want, and then being willing to take risks, personal risks. And you know, gamble on yourself, and obviously people have to be willing to give you that opportunity. But it's incredibly powerful to ask, and then to the point Mike made earlier, you might not get that opportunity you just asked for. But there's like an invisible line that forms behind every sort of role in an organization, and if you didn't get that job, but you really handled it in a way that you were a viable candidate, you were rightfully on the slate, you're sort of in that invisible line in their minds. And having mentors and having sponsors, even better, is another way that you can make sure that you're being thought of for opportunities.
Ask a male boss to come to this conference next year. And you know what? Even if half of you are successful,
yeah, absolutely.
Right there. Start now and ask for a male boss to come to this conference with you.
I'd love to touch on the point that you made, though, which is for a long time the dialogue has been about how do we behave differently so that we can be successful because we're too womanly, right? Be more like a man. And I had an interesting conversation with my daughters about this because their perception was very much, you know, anyone can do it, Mom, because you did. I'm like, oh, no. Let me tell you, there's never any men in the room, and there's never any women in the room in any of my meetings, right? So I was always the only woman. And a lot of the guidance I'd been given was be forceful. Keep your shoulders back. Don't apologize. Don't say sorry. Or don't say, I think maybe it would be a good idea if possibly we did something. And so I've been having a lot of coaching and heard a lot of speaking about how we should behave in a more forceful way. Mm-hmm. I completely disagree with that now. I have had a radical change of mind. Because if we do that, we lose the diversity. What's the point? The whole point of diversity is that women bring that higher level of EQ into the room. We bring that conflict dispersion into the room because we say things like, excuse me, I'm not saying that you're wrong, but I have an idea that maybe we could think about it this way, which is non-confrontational. So my new mantra, which I've told my girls, is don't change. Change the rules.
Lots of questions now. Barbara Kaufman. And then we're going to go back there.
Thank you. Barbara Kaufman, Newark Regional Business Partnership and Chair of the Board Appointments Committee for Executive Women of New Jersey. My question, you all represent very large organizations. How do women who are at small organizations, and let's face it, the majority of businesses either for-profit or non-profit, are medium to small businesses, how do those women seize opportunities to get the type of positions you're talking about, to be able to advance, to be able to get the career coaching, to have the male mentor, to be able to have all those opportunities that you all can, I mean, you can identify them and find them within your organization. It may be difficult, but you can find them. What do you do when you're in a smaller organization and those resources aren't available to you?
I think it's important for all of us, whether it's small or large organization, to be able to be courageous and to advocate for ourselves. But at the same time, as Philippa said, we need to be authentic. So I think, look, I've had this discussion with some of the women in some of the mentor circles and some of the women that I've mentored one-on-one. You don't know how your boss is going to react. So you need to start the dialogue. And then you need to gauge the reaction and know your audience. And then you actually have to make a personal decision about whether or not this is a culture that you feel comfortable continuing. If the person is open to having a discussion with you, maybe they didn't know that you were interested in that position. As you know, Liz was just saying, maybe they didn't know she'd be willing 1,000 weeks pregnant to get on a plane and go to Australia, right? But she had the courage to have that dialogue. But at the same time, you know, you have, this is all personal. You have to gauge and you have to know your personal situation and you have to be taking strategic risks. And then ultimately, you have to decide whether or not this is a place where you can thrive. So I do think, though, for women, if they can find, and even I'm finding now that I've been in this position of leadership for the last 2 years, I'm actually looking for other women who are in similar positions just to bounce ideas off of, because there aren't that many. I'm the first female CEO in Wyndham, and I look to others now that I've started to network with to get ideas about how they deal with some of their male counterparts, because it is very interesting to be the only woman in the room sometimes and to be told by some of my colleagues that maybe I need to take the pitch of my voice down. Well, I don't know how to do that without some kind of medicine. This is how I was made. Yeah, but it is interesting that you still get that kind of feedback.
She's so strident.
Yeah. Like wow, it really, and sometimes I wonder, does it hurt their ears? What's
true.
Happening?
That's it.
But anyway, I do think it's evolutionary. I know we want a revolution. I totally get it. I'm right there with you. But some of this is evolutionary. And each one of us, as Mike said, if each one of us brought a male colleague next year, we would start to change the dynamic more quickly.
And also, it can be easier said than done, but if you don't see the kind of programs that you wish you had at the organization that you're in, consider building it. You know, I know at Johnson & Johnson, we have a women's leadership initiative that started in 1995, and it started with four women going to the corporate governing committee and saying, you know, we want to give a presentation on women and a women's group that's needed. And they tell the story, and it's very funny, where it was like everybody just wanted them to, like give the presentation, and they weren't sure what, you know, they were really worried about, and then they wanted to give them the money and, like, go. And they say that sort of tongue-in-cheek, because in fact what happened was they were given funding without a question. It has been very supported at the company. It wasn't easy for them to do that, probably. It now has 170 chapters worldwide, and every time I travel to another site or country, I look to hold a WLI chat. And it's so interesting to see who turns up. You know, often it's just a very small group of women. Sometimes it's women and men. And whenever possible, if I'm traveling with a colleague, and it's especially great if it's a male colleague, or my boss, who happens to be a man, our general counsel, will join one of these sessions, because it shows that it is not some underground, you know, women's group. It is valued, it's respected, and, you know, it's given credit. So I think that it may start small, but you're building something that will help other people. And if you can co-opt, and again, a male colleague, it helps to say, let's go do this together. It's great for you, it's great for the women who come after you, and it's frankly great for him to be part of building that.
Did you have a comment,
Well, Bernie? Well, just that I think Liz's story is an example of the men were fearful, they wanted the women to go away, they gave them authority and money, and the women took great advantage of that.
Never, you know, let the facts get in the way of a good story. I don't actually know if that's how it unfolded, but that's what I was told.
But so to respond to the question, take advantage of that.
Yeah.
And I think the threshold is there respect in the workplace? Just basic respect for one another in the workplace. And if you have that, then take that chance to go to the male boss and say, I really want to improve on my career. I really want to develop as a leader. I'd like some help. Will you mentor me? Can I do this? Can I do that? And maybe he'll be fearful and say, yeah, just do it all, whatever you want to do.
Freak them
out. But otherwise, you might get a really solid mentor who initially was a little leery about becoming a mentor and a sponsor for you in that, you know, mid-market and smaller operation.
And I think
I think
that I always start with kill them with competence, and then you'll have their attention. So if you kill them with competence and they know that you're a competent associate, they're going to be more, everybody is going to be more apt, women, men, whomever, are going to be more apt to listen to your ideas.
Good morning. Thank you. Taking it to the next level, let's assume that we've all taken the advice, we've worked our way up, we've had people who are pulling as they climb, and now we're in a position to be near the C-suite or just top management. How are you seeing the ensurement of the pay equity question. So here we are, we've done what we need to do, we've paid the dues, we have good mentors, and now we're at the table and we're at the negotiating table in terms of a contract or even in a small organization that you know the ability is only going to be somewhat limited because of the size of the organization, should by no means limit the pay of that CEO or top management. And women face that all the time. So if you're going to slap the title of CEO, CFO, COO on a woman, what are you saying to make sure that that title equates to the same pay as if it were the male?
Tough one.
It's absolutely a great question. I actually think the good news, I think every major company I talk to is talking about this as an issue and knows that they have to solve it. So no one's saying it's not an issue and no one's saying it doesn't need to be solved. So I actually do believe that it's not as easy as, in my mind, it's not as easy as what we see in the press, which says sometimes women pay isn't equal to men pay in this position. You have to dig under the data analytics around it, because there could be situations where it's really around experience too. We got to make sure that it's not saying there's a general problem in every position. The answer has to be your position is, what is the role worth? Is the person in that role getting paid the same regardless of their equity? This one is very, very complex because of the, I would say, inaccuracies in some of the data that's reported. It's an issue at every company. I know, like at our company, it is being addressed, but we have to make sure that we're doing it the right way. The example you said, which is kind of job specific, not person specific, because there could be a performance issue. You could have a woman CEO and a male CEO, and if the woman CEO is not performing like a male CEO, her pay probably shouldn't be equal to the male CEO, and a man should be less than a woman CEO if she's not performing. So you have to be very, very careful with this one, I think, because we don't hear all the problem around that. We just hear kind of the headlines.
I think also that it does come down to experience. And when we think about it, there's women right now in many of these positions just don't have as much experience. So it is specific, one by one, case by case, that has to be examined.
And part of it is just the way you as a female negotiate. If a company has, I'm making this up, $200,000, they really need to save some money, and if they can offer you $180,000 and you'll take it, then, right?
I got some great advice once, which was always ask for 30% more than you're comfortable asking for.
It's terrifying.
And
isn't it?
As a woman, and then when I talk to my male colleagues, they're like, well, of course I would have asked for that. It's like, oh, okay. Because we do tend to under ask as well. Now, that shouldn't be an issue. We should be offered the right pay, but I'm just saying, as an individual, be bold, because the worst thing that's going to happen is people are going to say, are you crazy? No, you can have 15% more, which maybe was 5% more than you were going to ask for.
Yes.
Well, and I think adding into that exact problem of the pay equity once you make it to that level is, if you're talking about a small business, and I'm kind of at this point now, okay, so to get into the smaller, medium-sized business in the next position is going to require ownership. In the insurance industry right now, huge buyouts. I know what you mean about P&C being male dominated.
Yep.
But I'm getting all those opportunities. So I'm at the point now where I could make that next leap. But to make it make business sense, as you also brought up, I have to be in a position to buy into that position. And if I've spent my whole career being kind of routed into areas where I'm likely to get paid less anyways, so I'm not building up the equity, I don't have that fund behind me, it's more difficult for me to build my position into something where I can say I'm contributing this much to the bottom line. And so you kind of hit this wall where there's just a gap that's too big to get over, because you don't have the means to get the finance, you don't have the personal bank account to handle the financing. So how do you make that justification to the owners of the company that you're now ready to buy in, it's fair to the other partners that are already there? So I feel like I have to get a gift almost at this point from somebody to make that next step, or I have to leave a company altogether that I'm very committed to and step out to the side like a lot of women my age and start my own firm, which is really not something I'm looking to do. I'm committed to what I've already built. So that's another real significant problem that's part of the infrastructure issue to me.
And probably not gender specific.
Oh, right? No.
Yeah, and here today, it's very hard to conceive of real solutions with regard to this problem. I mean, I agree that it's highly complex in our industry. I just pulled out the stats that I read 2 weeks ago. Insurance and financial services, women get paid 52% of what the men get paid. Now, that's a very broad number, but that's highly disturbing. And I would say that this is another marketing opportunity to get the men here and to have a session, you know, in the future that is focused on, you know, pay equity. Because when you look at the market as we do for significant positions, it's gender neutral. So people in our company, people are getting paid what the market bears. But there are so many different elements to it at the small business and medium-sized level. And there's clearly a tremendous disparity, and that needs to be addressed as part of this broader conversation.
When you have a large organization, it's easier because we bring people in. Everybody out of college makes the same amount of money, whether you're male or female. So if every person stayed there for their whole career, we probably wouldn't have an issue. But what happens is when you do direct and hires, senior hires, that's what actually where the problem is created. So the problem doesn't start right. Everybody is offered the same amount of money at the beginning, but then women are leaving the workforce more than men are, and then when they're getting replaced, to Philippa's point, they're not. That's where the issue is in terms of when people come into an organization at a more senior level. So I think that's the way we could solve it, is making sure that in companies, when you're bringing in people with experienced hires, that you do look at what the norm is. Forget about what you think you can get away with paying them. You should pay them what that role is worth. Have the pay locked in before you make the job offer.
Yeah, and there's a systemic issue there too. So lateral moves, especially in financial services, people will usually not offer more than about a 30% increase for a lateral move.
Right.
So you're going from JP Morgan to Citi or Citi to Bank of America. They'll look at what you had and they'll bump you up a little. Now, if you've been working in banking for 25 years, you have built in a depression on your salary. So every time you make a lateral move, it's only going to be 30% up, which means you're never actually going to get to peer level pay. And that is an issue as in the senior roles in banking as well, which is why you see a lot of women also falling away at the top, because they just become, you know, disenchanted with that.
Just a few more minutes, yes.
Sure, I'm loud enough, but hi everyone, I'm Bailey. I am a coach for ambitious entrepreneurs and leaders, and I help them to master their mindset. So in speaking, you know, in hearing the panel and everything that you have to offer, I think it's fantastic. One of the things that I'd love to hear you speak about is the difference between the pushing effort versus the pulling effort. So the pushing effort that has gone on for many, many years, rightly so, of, you know, wanting to bust through glass ceilings and kick down doors, which has been needed. Mary Alice, you made that point especially. But I also think that there's a real value to the pulling effort, that women who are at the top seeing talent amongst themselves and saying, hey, come with me. Even where we all are right now, seeing women who are, you know, making efforts and saying, hey, I'll mentor you even where I am right now. You know, rather than always feeling like we have to push, let's build by pulling in. So I'd love to, you know, hear more from the panel on your own experiences of seeing talent and really pulling them in and how we can learn to do that ourselves.
I would go so far as to say we have a moral duty to pull people up. Because at this point, I consider myself right now somewhat, and this sounds a bit strange, but somewhat in a position of privilege. And so if I have this ability and I have a position where I can make a difference, I have to make a difference. And if I don't, shame on me. So that means not just the next level down, but levels five down. And I find myself quite often coaching people two levels or three levels below me to say, you need to be looking at that person who you are discounting their abilities because of their racial background or their sexual orientation or the fact that they're a woman, and you're uncomfortable with that, you need to pull them up, and we're going to show you how.
And it comes back to what we were talking about earlier about the need for infrastructure, because people doing things, that's great. All of us as individuals, that's great. But it's not enduring. It's not sustainable. You do need to make it something that's embedded. And I had a wonderful experience about 2 years ago. One of our very high-level lateral hires is a woman at Johnson & Johnson, and she was invited to speak at a session of the Women's Leadership Initiative. And she gave some very inspiring comments, and she sort of exhorted everybody who was there, exhorted them to not pull up the ladder, right? So using the nomenclature of climbing ladders and glass ceilings. And that was all nice. And then she went, it got real. She took it one step further. She said, in fact, I'm looking around this room, and it was a fairly small room of women. She could see all of us. And she said, and I'm challenging every single one of you because to come to the next meeting with a sponsoree. She said, I know you all mentor people, I'm sure you do. She's like, but now you need to figure out, you know, who you're going to sponsor, and it, and I would like it to be a millennial, because we're looking to plant seeds, you know, earlier. And you need to show up at our next meeting with that sponsoree. And it really was fascinating what that did. And she said, one's great, two's better. Every single person showed up at the next session, which was 6 months later, with what we ended up calling protégés. And one of mine actually left the company, not because of me, but because of a different opportunity. And I was like in a little bit of a panic, because I was like, I hope the other one can make it, you know? I mean, it's not, the point isn't just to show up, because that's sort of the cosmetic aspect of it. But, you know, the optics and the positive pressure firmly applied of that challenge has been phenomenal. And so this group has continued for the past, it's been 18 months now, so, you know, that we've had, you know, 2 years since our challenge, 18 months since we've had this program in place. And these folks help plan subsequent meetings of this executive women's leadership group. And it really, it gave more sort of skin in the game to it. And so now what we're working on is how do we make that more enduring, right? So that if and as we drop out, we don't lose the momentum of this.
But I also think it is our responsibility, so I totally agree with Flippa, but it also is, it becomes contagious. And I think there's also this point that was made earlier about how we were taught to act more like men early on our careers and to push really hard. And then you get to a certain point in your career, a certain level of management, where you actually have to be more diplomatic. Right, we've pushed so hard, and I've actually been spending time lately helping women to make that transition from that middle management to the senior management position, because that's what got you to this place is not going to take you to the next level. And what I'm finding is my male counterparts are asking me, I don't know how to talk to her. She's too aggressive in meetings, she's too combative, and she needs to be let people speak. This is where I really feel like we need a lot of help for to develop women leaders, because they can understand how to be more aggressive to get to a certain level, but then they now really need to learn how to become true leaders and help nurture the people below them, male, female. They need to be able to help them to grow and develop as well. So I do think, though, it is contagious, so we do have the responsibility, all of us, to help other women who want to continue to grow and prosper in their careers, but then we also need to help women to make that transition.
I'd say go so far as to look for people. Now, that challenge, go find a protege. There was a woman who worked for me 10 years ago in a more junior role, and I was looking to fill a position where I am now. And I thought of her and thought, she's been doing it for 10 years now. She has 10 years experience. I wonder what she's doing now. And I called her and said, have you thought about how you should be in a leadership role by now? And she said, well, not really. I said, well, let's go for it, have a drink. So we had a couple of drinks. I met with her twice. By the time we met the third time, she was lit up with ambition. She's like, I want to be a leader and I want to be in charge. And I said, I thought you should. And she's actually starting with us next week. So I think you have to go out and find people who you know have talent, but maybe don't have the confidence, and just pull them up with you.
I think that's probably the hardest job of any executive, is your first order of business is to replace yourself.
Yes.
Right.
Right? Mm-hmm. And that takes a lot of confidence to do that. And is that part of what holds women back?
Well, I would say it's it's common to men and women, and it's succession planning, and our technical term for it, as a mid-market operation, and in the smaller market, you have to prepare for the future, and it's a responsibility of each executive in the organization, right? If you want an organization that is going to sustain itself, you have to have the talent in the pipeline. So women executives, male executives have to bring up that talent, pull them up. That's the job. And I can't tell you how many times I've told more senior executives, I promise you will never ever succession plan yourself out of a job. You will only give yourself more opportunities with our organization by being really good at pulling people up.
And on that wonderful note, thank you all for being here. Bernie Flynn, Elizabeth Forminard, Mike Fucci, Philippa Gerling, and Gail Mandel. Thank you.